Hello, we're back, aren't we? Okay. This is the next lecture in teaching you all how to do a cash flow statement. And by the time you leave today, you'll be able to do a whole cash flow statement. We're going to do one in class today. Now, before we go there, I always like to review a little bit. So looking at the slides, we're learning how to do a cash flow statement. We talked about the sort of questions that a cash flow statement answers and why it's useful. We talked about cash equivalents, and we talked about the three sections of a cash flow statement, didn't we? Now, and then we went through and started talking about the importance of classifying cash flows between operating, investing, and financing, okay? All right, let's go ahead and do this. Let's act like this is a quiz. Don't look at your notes. This is a quiz I've given before in classes. And let's just see if we can do this. Jot down 1 through 8 on your piece of paper that you have in front of you. And you don't need to play the music or anything, but just answer these real quick. All right, you folks at home, if you want to pause it real quick. But I want to see if you know how to answer these. So just jot 1 through 8 down and either O, I, F, or N next to it. I'll just give you about 15 seconds to do that. All right. See if I can make that a little larger for you folks in the back. Okay. Just copy your answer down. So you're committed to an answer, okay? Hope you all have made your flashcards. The importance of making those flashcards will start to become even more evident today as we start to do a complete cash flow statement, okay? As I've said before, if you don't know on the cash flow statement where to place something, it's not going to be done correctly and it'll be of little use, okay? All right, you may not be done, but let's go ahead and go through the answers to here. Paid salaries in cash, what type of cash flow is that? That is an operating. Purchased a delivery van for the business?
Investing.
That is an investing. Purchased inventories for cash?
Operating.
Bought a long-term investment in another company?
Investing.
That's investing. Borrowed cash by signing a long-term note payable. What do you think?
Financing.
Paid cash dividends? That is also financing, isn't it? Okay. Converted preferred stock to common stock? That is a non-cash. And what about collected cash on principal on a long-term note receivable? No.
Investing.
It's a long-term note receivable, so it's on the left side. Okay? So are you guys starting to get to know these? All right. Okay. Then once we did that, going back to the computer, then we started talking about how we're going to do the indirect method. We're going to focus on that today because it is used most often. And then we went to this slide, where we are turning a net income number, let me get my pointer going. We are taking a net income number, which comes off the income statement, and it is based on the accrual basis. And we're going to do some things to it, aren't we? We're going to add back our non-cash expenses, such as depreciation, amortization, bad debt expense, and depletion. Are those your four? Then we're going to add back our losses and subtract out our gains, correct? So that we can kind of negate the effects, all right? And then we're going to analyze the changes in our current assets and in our current liabilities. There's only one current asset we will not analyze in this way, and what is that?
Cash.
That's because the whole statement is an analysis of the change in cash. And then basically what we're going to arrive at is a net income sort of a number if we would have used the cash basis. Now, don't forget the overall objective of what we are doing here. We're turning an accrual number into a cash flow basis. Thus, we add those non-cash expenses back because They were originally deducted in arriving at net income. By us adding them back, we are in fact negating their effect entirely. Correct? Losses were originally subtracted in arriving at net income. We want to add those back to negate their effect. Same thing with subtracting out gains, okay? And then we analyze the changes in the current assets and current liabilities using this little chart right here. Cool? So I had you do that handout, correct? Let's take a look at the answers, all right? Now, we went through 1 through 10 in detail last time we met. Let's take a look. I know we've gone through 11 through 13 before, but let's take a look at, I don't know if I can get all these on the same. Yeah, maybe I can sneak it in there, okay? Now, you all had check figures, correct? Okay, so did you arrive at those check figures? Did you ever do what you thought you were doing it correct? And by golly, it didn't line up with the check figure, and you said, oh, where did I make a mistake? And then you look back at it and you go, oh, that's right. I don't add a decrease in accounts payable, I subtract it, right? Like I said, it is extremely easy to make a mistake doing this. So what I recommend students do is they figure up these answers, and then they cover up their answer and redo it and see if they arrive at the same number, okay? Now, hopefully when you did your homework, you didn't just give me numbers. You gave me the explanations too, and you'll see why I wanted you to do that today, okay? All right, any questions on 11 through 15? I'm gonna highlight 13 and 15 a little bit more. Any questions on that? Let's take a look at the next ones. Let's take a look first at 16, 17, and 18, okay? And if you had trouble arriving at those check figures, here's how we got there, okay? Now, when we get into 16, 17, and 18, you're starting to do all three of those changes together, right? Okay? You've got some non-cash expenses that you need to deal with. You've got some losses you need to add back, or perhaps a gain you need to subtract out. And then you have to analyze the changes in the current assets and current liabilities. Did I give you any long-term assets or long-term liabilities and try to fool you and see if you dealt with those? We don't deal with those in the operating section, do we? Okay? All right, 16, 17, and 18. Any questions on that one? Okay. Or not on those, I should say. Let's take a look at 19, and then we're going to spend a little bit more time on 20. There is the answer to 19. Okay. There's the answer to 19. Okay. Maybe by number 19 you'd gotten lazy and you'd stopped writing things out and you'd just put in pluses and minuses by those numbers. And well, 19, I made you go back to the old method again, didn't I? Okay? All right. I really want to know if there's any questions on any of those. Anything? Are you feeling okay with it? All right, let's take a look at 20. 20 was a little bit more difficult, wasn't it? Okay. I'm going to go ahead and do 20. Okay? Let's take a look at the original problem, okay? The reason I like to end with this one is because this is more like real life, isn't it? Okay? Where you have a balance sheet, you have an income statement, and you have to figure them out. It's not just listed easily for you, okay? So let's go ahead and do this one. Okay, we're going to start with the... If I start writing and you can't see it, let me know, but we have the net income of how much? 16,650. And of course, we pull that right there, right? Okay. Now, the first thing I do is look for any non-cash expenses. Do we have any non-cash expenses we need to add back? Yes, we have depreciation expense. Okay. Now, We'll add that back, depreciation expense plus 5,800, correct? Now you might say, well, how do I know that there's no non-cash expense in those other expenses? Well, you have to kind of assume. There's no way I could have asked you to know that, right? So non-cash expenses, especially depreciation, amortization, depletion, those are usually always separate line items, okay? So they're not going to be buried, all right? So that's the first thing. Do we have any gains or losses that we need to add back or subtract out or whatever?
No.
But now we have some current assets we need to analyze, correct? On some current assets and current liabilities, right? We need to analyze accounts receivable, inventory, accounts payable, and salaries payable. Is that correct? Now, of course, cash isn't a current asset, but we don't analyze the change in it, right? Okay, I'm going to just list what the change is right here. What's the change between these two numbers? Is it 4150? Okay, it's a 4150. Is that an increase or decrease?
Decrease.
It's a decrease. Okay. How much did inventory change by? 11,990? Okay. And did that increase or decrease?
Increased.
Accounts payable, the change there is 3180. Did that increase or decrease?
Increase.
And salaries payable looks like it increased by 500. Would you agree? Okay. So now what we do is we write those down. Okay. And actually, I could just show you the. At this point, I could just show you the answer, and it'll be neater than my writing. Okay. But we pulled these two numbers off the income statement. Then we calculated the changes in those other ones. Decreases in current assets, we add. Increases in current assets, we subtract. Increases in current liabilities, we add. And thus we get a cash flows from operating activities of 18,290. Is that correct? How many people got that? Okay, a few of you? Okay. Any questions on that?
Yeah, I have a question.
Haley.
I kept adding in accumulated depreciation on the equipment just because that's equipment long term, so you don't add that, right?
Okay, that's a great question. I'm glad you asked that. What she is asking about is accumulated depreciation, okay? And what you might have been, and this is a common question, and sometimes people say, okay, I know you add back depreciation expense as a non-cash expense. Do we analyze the change in accumulated depreciation or do we take it off the income statement? Okay, here's your answer. Always take it off the income statement. Always. Because there could be more than one thing going on in that accumulated depreciation account. We credit accumulated depreciation when we make a depreciation entry, right? And so sometimes the change in your accumulated depreciation will be the same number as your depreciation expense on your income statement, but not always, and I don't think it was the same in this one. Well, that's because there's something else that affects accumulated depreciation. If we sell an asset, remember how we take the asset off the books and we debit accumulated depreciation? Okay? So there's more than one thing going on between that beginning and ending balance of accumulated depreciation. So in summary, always take your depreciation expense off your income statement. Almost every, I cannot think of an income statement that did not have that as a separate line item. Great question. Okay? All right. All right, any other questions on that? Okay, what I want to do now is this. I am going to give you an exercise, and we're going to work in class, okay? Now, keep that on there while I pass this out. This is OTW Corporation. And of course, you folks watching this, you have all these handouts. You know where to find them, okay? Now, I'm going to tell you what I want you to do, all right? You have this OTW Corporation. What I want you to do is get a brand new piece of paper out, and I want you to, let's say this is your piece of paper, okay? I want you to start at the top, and I want you to figure out your cash flows from operating activities, okay? But I want you to do it at the top of a new piece of paper, because when you're done, we're going to add to the bottom of it, and I want you to have room to work. Does that make sense? So what we're doing with the OTW Corporation while the music rolls is we are going to calculate the cash flows from operating activities. Do it at the top of the sheet. We're going to do it just like we did. Don't just calculate the number, though. Write out the descriptions of how you arrived at the number, okay? And I'm going to go ahead and give you the check figure, okay? The check figure is $216,000 even. 216,000. So you folks at home, do the same thing at the top of a new piece of paper. Calculate your cash flows from operating activities. I'll see you in a few minutes.